Hi, everybody. Thank you so much for joining us in celebration of Women's History Month. My name is Annabelle Haudigi, and I'm the Administrative Assistant for the Department of Multicultural Affairs. Behind me, you'll see Diana Cordova, and she's the Director for the Department. For our presentation today, we have Vaneese Thomas. She's an American singer and songwriter with an authentic link to the early years of soul and rhythm and blues. She will showcase the origin of folk music, what known as blues, and the woman who popularized it. She takes us on a journey from America's rural South to today's urban scene and shows us how the blues influenced all American music that followed it. Vaneese has sung with major artists from Aretha Franklin, Michael Jackson, and Sting to Luciano Pavarotti. I hope I said that right. Just a reminder that you are all encouraged to participate and ask questions via the chat. There will also be a survey at the end of the presentation, so we greatly appreciate it if you could fill that out for us. I will now let Ms. Vaneese take it away.
Good evening. How's everybody? I'm Vaneese Thomas. I'm originally from Memphis, Tennessee, and now living in the New York area, but I still got those Southern roots. So that's why I wanted to talk to you not only about the blues, but about the women who helped create it and who helped carry it forward. I came from a very musical family. I'm gonna try to see if I can hold this up to the camera so you can see it a little bit. That is Rufus Thomas, who was a very famous R&B and blues singer, but he had big hits in the 60s, like you probably have heard, Walking the Dog, or the Funky Chicken, and Push and Pull, and all those novelty dances. He was a great dancer, as well as being a great singer. So I got it in my blood, in my bones. and I wanted to share my origins with you so you'll know from whence this music comes that I sing and that I write. All right, let's start talking about the blues in particular. The blues has been defined by so many different people, but this is how I see it. It's the melancholic music of African Americans who of folk origins, expressing the state of mind, feelings, and realities of the Black experience. So this music started in the Southern US and in the late 19th century. And you know, there are so many different cities who claim to be the home of the blues. There's Memphis, New Orleans, St. Louis, and a lot of different places, but we don't really know for sure where the blues started. And there were simultaneous beginnings. You know, people from different places were doing different styles. For example, in New Orleans, there was Dixieland. In Memphis, there was sort of juke joint blues. And in the farther south, like Mississippi, Alabama, there were people who just picked up the instrument. They may not even have had six strings on their guitar, but they would sit around and rock on the front porch and get sounds out of these homemade instruments, including the banjo. And most people don't know this. They equate the banjo with Appalachian music or country music from Nashville. But that's not the case. The banjo in its earliest lute form with four strings came from West Africa. So when you hear the banjo in country music, you can't always assume that it was created by the people who are playing it now, but it has its origins in the Black community. So I'm actually making a new record right now that's blues and folk and Americana, all of those grassroots, you know, bluegrass music, they all come from the same beginnings with our American music, and they've blended. So I'm making a record now to show that blend, that, you know, down home blues, that traditional thing. Also Americana with the banjo and with the mandolin and piano and slide guitar. You've seen Bonnie Raitt play her guitar, and she uses that thing on her fourth finger. And some people use glass, some people use metal, but that produces, when you slide on a guitar string, that produces a slur. And we're gonna talk about slurs in the voice as well as slurs in the music. During the slavery period in American history, there was this need for a catharsis, if you know what that means. It's a purging. So people were in turmoil emotionally and physically and psychologically, and they needed some musical outlets, a catharsis to make life bearable for them as they were doing their toil. And this quote about the catharsis of blues music comes from Eileen Southern. In case you want to take notes tonight, I've got a lot of good stuff to say, so you can take a few notes and go look up the origins for yourself, so you'll have a little more familiarity. But that quote is from Eileen Southern, who wrote a beautiful book called The Music of Black Americans. She talks about jazz and homegrown blues. And she also talks about how spirituals were taken and carried all over the United States and eventually all around the world by ex-enslaved Africans. So it's a good book to refer to. Original blues songs were mournful because they incorporated the feelings of the people about what they were having to go through. And field hollers, meaning the kinds of songs people sang on the plantation out in the fields, and the call and response, if you know what that means, which became the basis of the blues and rhythm and blues. Like someone, Aretha will say, I need respect. And the groups behind her sings, just a little bit, respect, just a little bit, respect, just a little bit, respect. Just. So that's call and response. That was also created by these people in the fields. They couldn't always be near each other, so they would create music where it would bounce off of one another and they could sing and influence one another in their singing. So also it was started by people who were on the chain gang, people who were working on the railroad, people who were stevedores, and that's people who were working, unloading boats, dock hands. So wherever there are African-Americans working, there were these songs being created to tell the stories of their lives, of their toil, sometimes of their sheer misery. So these hollers and sorrowful songs became blues and became spirituals. These evolved after slavery. And as African-Americans were migrating, they would take these songs from town to town. And from they were migrating from the South to the North, where Chicago and Detroit, Memphis was the first stop because it was closest to the Delta. Y'all know that's where the music got started, right? In the Delta of the Mississippi River. So Memphis was an important stopping point along the way where that music came together. And then the migrating ex-slaves would take it to Chicago, Detroit, West, eventually to LA, and eventually to New York. So their traveling and their migration helped this music travel all around the country and eventually all around the world. Most frequently, the traditional blues has a three-line stanza, of which the second line is a restatement of the first line, and the third line is a contrasting statement. So for example, woke up this morning feeling sad and blue. That's the first line. And then the second line restates that. Woke up this morning feeling sad and blue. And the third line is something different, but related to those first two lines. And in this case, it's didn't have nobody to tell my troubles to. So that's how that got started in terms of stating what you're trying to say in a blues form. And that blues form became standardized after a while. People began to form it into 12 bars. And nowadays you can change it, it's evolving. You can have an 8-bar blues, you can have a 16-bar blues. But traditional blues is really called a 12-bar blues. And it can expand or shrink depending on the person. For example, the people I was telling you about who would sit on their front porches and play these homemade instruments, sometimes they would stretch it out because they weren't aware of any standard form. So I'm gonna sing a little bit of what that 12-bar blues would be. The blues melody would derive from the scale. They would hear, you would hear, that's a C scale. And to make it blue, or that's where the blues comes from, you create blue notes, you would lower the third note of the scale. That sounds more mournful, right? And sometimes they would lower the sixth, and then they'd always lower the seventh. So you get blues that doesn't sound like this, but sounds like this. Oh, yeah. So that's a lot more mournful and expressive than a straight major scale. So I'm gonna tell you, the first four bars would be on the first degree of the scale. And then the next two bars would be the fourth degree of the scale, a chord formed on that. And then the two bars after that would go back to the one of the scale. And then the next bar would go to the five of the scale. And most of the time in the early days, it stayed there. And then the next two bars went back to the first. Now, since we've altered the blues just a little bit, that five would go for two bars, or one bar. And then some people go to the fourth degree of the scale for a bar, and then go back to the one. So you could do it either way. I hope some of you out there are singers and songwriters, and you probably know this and use these slurs and blue notes all the time. So I'm gonna sing that first one, that those lines that I repeated for you, but now I'll sing them on the degrees of the scale they're built on. Woke up this morning feeling sad and blue. Well, I woke up this morning Okay. So that's how the blues developed. So if you were sitting on your front porch and you had no sense of 16 bars, you didn't know any formal music education. So a lot of the early blues, woke up this morning, I was feeling sad and blue. So you see, they stretch it out. Woke up this morning, oh, feeling sad and blue. Oh yeah. So you can see how it can be shrunk or elongated depending on who's singing it. But it has evolved now for us in the traditional blues form, has become a 12 bar blues. But those folks didn't know nothing about 12 bars. They just sang it from their hearts. All right. So there, the women I want to talk about in today's webinar are the early blues mavens, meaning the great women of that era. The early era of the 20s, 1920s, and 1930s. Believe it or not, the first record that was recorded, the blues record that was recorded by an African-American woman was in 1920, a long time ago. And it's hard to believe. My husband and I were discussing how they were made. If you've ever seen an old phonograph, you know, it's the record player that spins. But in those days, it had a big horn on it. It looked like the bell of a tuba. You know, it was that big. And the way that they recorded them was direct onto a piece of acetate, which is plastic. It was very thick, hopefully, so it wouldn't break during manufacturing. And the stylus, you know what that is? Those of you young folk, you know what vinyl is and all that stuff. I don't have to explain it to you. But you know, when you put the stylus on the record, it spins. So these women were recording directly into the horn. And it was you put the stylus on while you were singing and they were playing behind you. And it was being engraved into those acetates. And believe it or not, some of them were so thick and durable. We still have some from 100 years ago. And I wanted my husband to play that very first song. It's by Mamie Smith that was recorded in 1920. It's called Crazy Blues.
Now I got the crazy blues. Since my baby went away, I ain't got no time to lose. I must find him today. Now the doctor wanted to know that he can, but what he's gonna need is a undertaker man.
All right, that's Mamie Smith singing the Crazy Blues, recorded in 1920, believe it, 101 years ago. We think of recording industry as being so recent, but now that we've gotten all these, the evolutions of technology, it's been around a long time. So there were two types of blues that was being sung and recorded in the 1920s and 30s. There was the rural life stories, because that's what the blues is. It's the stories of our lives and what we've gone through and our experiences. So the rural stories talked about what was going on the farm, crop failure, floods, the endless toil, all kinds of things that might happen on a farm that would be very difficult, a lifestyle. So those were the traditional blues men and women, and they talked about their rural lives. Then there was the urban perspective. There were women who were in the migration, the Black migration, that went from the South to the North, West, and then East. And these migrating African-Americans were taking their Southern heritage and getting to a new place in a city, very different than where they came from. And they were changing the style to become more urban. In fact, it's they took their juke joints. You know what a juke joint is? Juggin' or jukin', depending on where you come from, was dancing. That's another name for early forms of dancing in the African-American community. So the early days of jukin took place in a juke joint. And the ones in the South only had, you know, a log cabin with dirt floor and maybe three musicians, somebody playing guitar, maybe a fiddle, maybe a banjo. But it would be a place of respite for the Black community, place that where they could go and let their hair down and be themselves and express their own ideals and ideas. So as these women were traveling north, they took those juke joints with them and they established them in Memphis and Chicago and Detroit and eventually New York. That's where Mamie Smith, who sang that song, The Crazy Blues, recorded. She recorded for a label called OK Records, O-K-E-H, OK Records. And they were determined to spread the word that Black music was, at first it was marketed only to the African-American community. But eventually they saw the value of marketing this to a broader community. So they recorded Mamie Smith sort of as a test case to see how this would go over in the United States in general. And it went over so well, they decided to market it to the dominant community as well and sold lots of records. And those kinds of songs were much more urban in feel. So they weren't talking about their farms and what they did in farm life. They were talking about fancy dressed men and women going to the clubs, the juke joints, gambling. And unfortunately, they talked a lot about the abuse and mistreatment of women in a lot of these songs. In fact, you'll still hear that in the blues today. It may not be physical abuse, but mental abuse. You know, my man done left me. I sit alone and cry. So that kind of blues is still going on. So that became the urban version of blues that was being recorded in the 1920s and 30s. And like I said, it was being carried from town to town by anonymous singers. So we don't know who started it or a certain style. We don't know who carried it from town to town, but everybody had their own style. And I believe now that blues should be an evolving thing because unfortunately, African-Americans in this country still have difficulties and challenges in this country, in our lives, and in so it needs to be expressed. And now we're expressing it. Of course, there's hip hop and R&B and all that stuff, but it all comes from the themes in the blues, and it comes from those chords. The mournful chords. So it's evolving, but it keeps that traditional blues bass. In fact, another woman writer who I just love, has written a book called The Black Pearls. And she talks about the women in the 20s and the 30s. Daphne Duval Harrison is her name. And she wrote that the blues women's contributions included increased improvisation on melodic lines, unusual phrasing, delivery of the lyric, if you will, and vocal dramatics using shouts, groans, moans, and other types of musical expressions that made the music so exciting. So before, where it might have been a mournful interior kind of sound, the women who expressed it more than the guys who sat on the front porch, rocked and played their homemade instruments, they brought a lot of what we consider pop music today. These things that these Black women created have gone on to create rock and roll, rhythm and blues, and pop music. For example, without the scoops and the slurs, I said I would tell you about that. So if you say, I got nobody, what happens on that first note? That's called a scoop or a slur. And that's what these women were bringing to the sound. And they were also bringing moans and I got the blues. So all of those scoops and slurs brought a different sensibility to delivering the lyric than just, I got the blues. That's kind of boring, right? They brought their guts and their hearts, and people began writing instrumentation to mimic those scoops and slurs. So when you heard Mamie Smith singing, she had clarinet, a trombone, a piano, and all those things behind her. They're doing their slurs and scoops as well. And it became Dixieland, it became jazz, it became blues. So this is what the women did to improve, shall we say, to help the blues to evolve. And I'm gonna sing the most well-known singer of the 20s and 30s and made the most money in her career. On stage, she did traveling shows, she did vaudeville, and that's what most of the Black entertainers were doing. In fact, there was a troupe of entertainers called the Rabbit Foot Minstrels that these women performed with. Mamie Smith, Bessie Smith, Ma Rainey, all of those women. And also the gentleman. When my father was a teenager, it shows you how far back my dad goes. He was a performer with the Rabbit Foot Minstrels when he was right out of high school. So these were opportunities for tent shows, vaudeville, and all these entertainers got to travel from town to town. And that's how this music was disseminated throughout the community. And Bessie Smith is the most famous of these women. And I'm gonna sing a song. It's not a pretty song. It's a mournful song about how her man done her wrong. But instead of crying at home and sitting back and taking it, unfortunately, she did something very violent. So this song by Bessie Smith, the lyrics by Bessie, is called Send Me to the Electric Chair. And she's willing to own up to her deeds. So that's about Miss Bessie Smith, the preeminent Black woman in the 1920s and 30s who sang the blues. There was a downturn of classic blues with the advent of swing music in the 30s. You know, the big bands, it was really still the blues, but it crossed over blues into jazz. So, you know, you had Duke Ellington, Count Basie, Glenn Miller, and all the big band people. And they had women singing with them, but the style of the music was nothing like this anymore. So a lot of these women, like Memphis Minnie, Victoria Spivey, Ida Cox, Ethel Waters, who, by the way, is a wonderful actress. If you've ever seen any of the Black movies made by Vincent Minnelli or earlier, she's in a lot of them. And Alberta Hunter, who lived in New York. So a lot of these women crossed over and started singing with the big bands. But those who no longer had the vaudeville was dying. They no longer had an outlet for their music. So it's unfortunate a lot of them did not persist and weren't not able to sustain themselves in the 40s and 50s. But later in the 50s, an interesting thing began to happen. The big bands started traveling with fewer instruments and fewer musicians. And they began to record them that way. So it wasn't, you know, like 30, 40 piece orchestra anymore. It became what we know now as a combo, guitar, bass, drums, piano, and that guitar sometimes was a had slide, but most of the time it kind of junk, 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 junk. So the style was changing, and as a result, we got it became rock and roll. In the late 40s, Ike Turner, believe it or not, from Tina Turner and Ike Turner, is reputed to have sung the first rock and roll song called Rocket 88, recorded on Sun Records. My father was also on Sun Records, and so were Howlin' Wolf and a lot of other blues artists who were transitioning into rock and roll. So just remember that all of these blues roots carried through and became rock and roll. In fact, this particular woman was able to take her blues roots and go right to rock and roll, and she became famous, but not the most famous person who sang this song. You ain't nothing but a hound dog, crying all the time. You ain't nothing but a hound dog, quit messing around my door. You can wag your tail, but I ain't gonna feed you no more. Now, most people know that song from Elvis Presley, and they consider that the beginnings of rock and roll. Well, Big Mama Thornton sang it first and co-wrote it, as a matter of fact. And that was her version that I just sang, which is much more blue, but still with that bass line, it became more rock and roll than blues. So Big Mama Thornton, Coco Taylor, Etta James, and Big Maybelle were some of the first women who were taking that blues bass and bringing it, evolving it into rock and roll in the 50s and early 60s. And, you know, it's unfortunate that on the radio, most of the men, which is why I wanted to talk about women in this industry, most of the men get the props. You know what I'm saying? You hear about Howlin' Wolf and Muddy Waters and B.B. King and Bobby Bland. Those are the people who get the most play on the radio. And there are far fewer women. They're out there, but they're just not getting the same attention. So what I want you to do is write down some of these names and try to look these women up and support them, because we're trying to keep the blues alive. There's Shamika Copeland, who you probably have heard of. Shamika's been around since she was a teenager. Larkin Poe is a female duo that's great. They've got great music out of Mississippi. There's Susan Tedeschi. You might know Derek Trucks. And there's Susie Tedeschi Trucks, their husband and wife. But she's a great blues singer. Ruthie Foster, who has been around for a long time and doesn't get as much airplay as I'd like to see her get. By the way, you can tune in to Bluesville if you have Sirius FM. It will kind of give you a taste of the old style and also show you some of the newer people who are coming into the blues field, because there's no dearth of folks singing the blues. And every year there is an IBC in Memphis, which is International Blues Challenge. So I encourage any of you who are blues singers or writers or know people, please send them down to the IBC next January and let them get a good look at what the blues industry looks like. And in May, there is the Blues Foundation Awards, and that happens every May in Memphis too. So the last person that I want you to check out is this person right here. I'm going to hold it up to the camera, see if you can see this. That's Vaneese Thomas. That's me. And there's a glare on it, I know. But I'm standing in a stream giving you old school blues so that, you know, it'll give you a feeling of down home. It's called Down Yonder. So if you're interested in going back to some old style blues, you can check this out. I have three blues albums out and in the process of making a new one. And hopefully that will be my path. And I hope that there are plenty of other women who are keeping the blues alive and would like to. I think I'm getting close to the end of my time. And I wanted to ask Annabelle if there were any questions either about my career or the career of any of the women I've talked about or blues in general that you might like to know about.
Yes, there's presently a question from Deanna, and she asked, when will the record on blues, folk, and Americana come out?
Ah, that will probably not be out until next spring. Recording it right now. And I'm real proud of the writing because I don't like to be put into a box or have people think, you know, there's only one thing that I can do. So I'm branching out and evolving, helping this blues music to evolve.
Awesome, thank you. And there's actually a comment from Cecilia, and she says, can I just have your voice, please?
That's a thank you so much for that comment. I appreciate that. I've been singing all styles of music. You know, when I was growing up, my daddy was also not only a performer, he was a DJ. So I had all kinds of records in my house, blues and jazz and gospel and spiritual. So I feel like I'm a combo of all those.
Oh, thank you. There's actually also a comment from Michelle. She says, I'm finding this to be very educational. One never hears about the woman of blues.
Ah, thank you for that. Yes, that's why I wanted to name some of them to you, because, you know, there's a story about, I haven't talked about the exploitation and control of record companies. I can do that on another day. But a lot of our women from the 1920s and 30s did not fare well financially. And they were being exploited by the record companies. Columbia signed a lot of Black women, and OK did several as well. And then RCA Victor did a lot of Black women. But they did not fare well financially. And unfortunately, a lot of them, I wouldn't say died penniless, but certainly were not able to maintain their their careers. And so they went into what the only things that African-American women could do at the time, which was maid service or clean houses or go into the factories in Detroit and Chicago. So it's unfortunate that that happened, but we'll talk about exploitation at another time. Any other questions?
Yes, there's another one by Charles that says, Miss Thomas, are you familiar with the blues work of Ruth Brown? I truly enjoy her work.
I knew Ruth very well. Ruth Brown was an amazing singer. And she started, it's interesting, she started kind of bluesy, jazzy in the mid 40s. But by the time 1950 arrived, Atlantic Records in New York City signed Ruth, and she had her first hit record. It might've been 49 or 50, but she became a mentor to my sister, Carla Thomas, who's also a great singer and songwriter. And when those women were touring in the late 50s and 60s, Maxine Brown and Ruth Brown were people who took my sister under their wing. And my daddy, I wish I had known, I wasn't thinking. I have great pictures, so maybe we can show those next time, or I can send them in to you so you can see. I have a great picture of my father and Ruth Brown hosting the Blues Foundation / W.C. Handy Awards. So yes, I knew Ruth very well, and she sang a song that I put in my show all the time. And it's called, what's that title? The Ruth Brown song, Teach. I was trying to think of the, Mama, you treat your daughter mean. Oh, oh, Mama, you treat your daughter mean. He's the meanest old man that I've ever seen. That's a Ruth Brown song, and I have it in my show all the time because I love her. Thank you for asking about Ruth.
That was such a beautiful song, and of course your beautiful voice just makes it better.
Thank you.
You can't see us because we mute ourselves, but every time you dance, we're like over
you
here.
You start dancing around. That's good.
We're dancing, yes. There's another question. It says, what are your thoughts on improvising as an instrumental and vocal?
Excellent idea. Is this a musician I'm talking to, a singer or an instrumentalist?
I'm not sure. It doesn't have a name.
Well, improvisation is very, very important in both singing and instrumentation. Like this. It's going to be different. It's going to be different every time you play it, you know. So improvisation is important. And the only way to improvise is to take music. You got to take music lessons and be serious about it. And the same vocally or instrumentally, it doesn't matter. And remember what I said about the women who were the ones who brought the improvisation to delivery of the lyrics, made the lyrics more interesting. And so, for example, I have written here, there would be no Christina Aguilera, no Ariana Grande, no Dua Lipa, no Lady Gaga without these women. So just remember that improvisation has influenced all of these current singers.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
I have another question. What song would you recommend as a first blues song for a youth band to play?
Youth band, okay. With a singer? Let's see, let me give you one without a singer, do an instrumental. You know, it's the beginning of rock and roll and R&B, but it really is a blues song. Green Onions by Booker T and the MGs. If a young band wanted to start playing, okay, that's, and he plays, Booker plays organ. He plays the melody up top, and then the Steve Cropper playing guitar. So I would say that would be an easy one to start with if you want to get your blues chops together.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. There's another question. This one's from Catherine. It says, I absolutely loved your presentation. I learned so much. Do you have a favorite performance you've done?
Say that last piece again.
Do you have a favorite performance that you've done?
Favorite performance that I've done? I've performed in Europe a lot. I perform in Italy a lot. I'd say the Porretta Soul Festival, because Porretta is a little teeny tiny town in Italy, and it shows you how much people in Europe have an appreciation for people of color who are doing indigenous music, like blues, soul, gospel. My father helped get that festival started, and they named the outdoor amphitheater after him. It's called Rufus Thomas Park. So I think that's my favorite place to perform and to pass that along to a world audience.
That's a beautiful answer. Thank you.
Thank you.
There's plenty of questions. You're very popular tonight.
Well, I appreciate that.
There's a question from Cecilia. She says, what's the best way to introduce blues to high school students who are unfamiliar with the genre?
I think this presentation would be a good one, because I talk about the early, early beginnings, like the end of the 19th century, as well as how it evolved and developed into the 20s and 30s. If this is being recorded, I don't know if it is, you're welcome to contact Annabelle or anybody there at the college and get a copy of this. I think this would be a good beginning for high school students.
Yes, so we're actually recording it, and we post it on our Multicultural Affairs YouTube page, and I'll post the link in the chat as well for anybody who wants to see it later or refer back to it. Definitely
glad to hear it, so that'll be helpful.
Yes,
because I do go and talk to high school students, even junior high school students. They're really eager about the music. You know, they want to get into the style and everything, but my feeling is that you have to have the basics first, you know, musically and content.
Thank you. And then, let me see. Oh, I had one up. I'm sorry. I posted on the bottom and it took me all the way. Okay. So there is a comment and a question from Dr. Gold. She says, was your voice given by the Lord, or was the vocal taught to you over the years of music education?
That's a very good question. And that's why I emphasize music education. Of course, this is God-given, but you can't hone your craft unless you work at it. So I sang in many, many choirs over the years. I sang in chorale in college. You know, I took piano lessons for 10 years. So I started from a point of my gift, but my mother in particular was intent on me honing the musical side in music education. So as a result, I have, you know, been an adjunct professor at a couple of colleges, and I believe that gives me a good foundation, you know, for my career and for my jumping off point.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Patrice asked, do you consider Billie Holiday a blues singer, such as in the song Strange Fruit?
Excellent question. And you know why? Because Billie started to sing in the 1930s. She became a different singer in the 1940s. Because the style was different, she started as a blues singer. And my feeling is, depending on the style of the jazz, for example, you could listen to Wynton Marsalis play things from his hometown of New Orleans, and they're bluesy jazz. And then there's Count Basie, who's more jump blues. So, and that became rock and roll. And that jump blues. But I believe that Billie Holiday was always a blues singer. Even when she sang Strange Fruit, she had other people writing for her. So she wrote the words, but Billy Strayhorn wrote the music. And he was much more jazz cat, who worked with Duke Ellington and had more of a jazz bass. So she was able to swing, you know, all those different directions because of her blues bass.
Thank you. There's another question from Dr. Cole. She said, who of the famous voices of the past are your absolute favorites? Hers is Ella Fitzgerald forever.
I bow at the shrine of Ella Fitzgerald. There was no one who is more influential on singers, past or present, than Ella. Ella has the enormous range. She has virtuosity. She can twirl and curl, all those things that I was talking about Christina Aguilera and Ariana Grande try to do, was done first by Ella. So I give her all props, and as being the mother of all indigenous American music. And I give, in the male section, I give those props to Louis Armstrong, a man who could scat, slur, scoop it, with his trumpet as well as his voice. So between the two of them, they laid the foundation, I believe, for anybody who came after.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Samuel has a question. He says, what are some of your favorite chords to sing with?
Favorite
chords.
Chords?
Yes.
That's an interesting question. I assume Samuel plays. I like all chords. I like all styles. So if I were to play, you know, that would be something more contemporary, you know, R&B. Everything is you. I like mellow music like that too. I like major sevenths. I like 11 chords. In fact, I first learned 11 chords from Elton John. Elton John's one of my favorite singers of all, and writers and piano players. He taught me a lot. So there's no particular chord that I prefer to sing with. But I certainly prefer singing with really, really talented instrumentalists, no matter what style they're in. Like I said, bluegrass, country, Celtic music, by the way. Are you familiar with Rhiannon Giddens? Rhiannon Giddens came from originally the band, the Carolina Chocolate Drops. Now she's an individual singer on her own and sings Americana blues, great historical stuff. So she can run the gamut as well. So I feel the same about myself, that I would, I like all kinds of chords.
Thank you for that answer. Mm-hmm. Cecilia says, I'm on Spotify right now and all the top songs on your page are from the Disney movie Hercules. How was that work on?
Yes, Hercules, my nod to young people. A lot of them know me from, and I just had a reunion with the Muses. We just did an online interview with an animation magazine, and she had several people, other writers there who were asking questions, you know, to get us, spark our memories of how we recorded in the Disney film. That was, I'd say, a highlight of my career. Being in the studio with all these other women, being in the studio with the animators who are watching you and drawing you, being in the studio with Alan Menken, who wrote all these beautiful songs like Beauty and the Beast and, you know, all of them. So that was a highlight of my career, because it was film, and it was something that I believe encouraged young women of color, because that was the first time Disney had ever done women of color in a Disney film. Princess Tatiana came later. The Muses were the first.
That's very interesting. Thank you. You're
welcome.
Michelle has a question. She says, how do I get started reading about women and blues in the current movement? Or sorry, the current moment.
Current women?
Or in the current moment, like, I guess, how does she get started on reading about women and blues?
Okay. Well, those two books, let me give you the first book. It's called The Black Pearls, and it's by Daphne Duval Harrison. And it's about all of those women I talked about today. In fact, many, 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 many more. And it talks about all facets of their careers. So you can learn the difficulties and the challenges, things I, you know, haven't talked about today. You can get started reading that book.
Thank you. And then there's one final comment and question.
Okay.
Kutso says, it was a good opportunity to know about the evolution of blues. And when should we expect a concert from you, since the third album is in the making?
Good question. And thank you for that. Well, I'm praying that this pandemic is winding down and that maybe this time next year, I can be at Eastern New Mexico and we can do a concert. How about that?
That sounds amazing. We'll definitely have to get together and plan something for that.
Sounds good.
Well, Ms. Vaneese, thank you so much for that beautiful presentation. You have a beautiful voice, and I think you left us all in awe. It was beautiful, you know, to be able to appreciate where blues comes from and how it's still alive to this day.
Yes, it is.
And I wanted to take this moment to remind everybody to please complete the quick survey at the end of the presentation. We greatly appreciate it. Our next event during Women's History Month is March 30th at 2 p.m. for an inspiring presentation on The Power of Choice by Dawn Shaw. She's a woman who lives her life to the fullest, despite, you know, half of her face being paralyzed. So if you're interested in tuning into her story, check your emails for the registration link. I hope everybody has a good night. And Ms. Vaneese, again, thank you so much for sending you a bunch of virtual hugs.
Thank you, and back at you. Thank you for having me, and I hope everybody enjoyed it.
Bye.
All right, bye-bye.